So there were a group of small business executives who were attending a conference, and during a break, they got together around a table for just some coffee and some talk, and so somehow the topic got on retirement, and so they were talking about retirement around the table. The youngest guy at that table was in his young 50s, and he said, "Oh, I love to talk about retirement. I love to think about retirement. I can't wait to retire. I talk about it a lot. I talk about it at home, and whenever I talk about it at home, my wife gets upset, and she says to me, 'Why do you want to retire? What are you going to do when you retire?'" And he said, "You know what I tell my wife? I tell my wife that when I retire, I am going to sit at home on the couch every day and watch TV." To which one of the other older, wiser gentlemen said to him, "You know, you'll be dead within a year if you actually do that." And he said, "What? I'll be dead within a year? Why would I be dead within a year?" And the gentleman looked back at me and he said, "Well, if the lack of purpose doesn't kill you, your wife will." Today we're talking about rewriting your purpose, and so let's pray before we study. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your word. Your word is always such a rich meal for us. And so, Lord, give us a palate for your word. Give us a hunger and a thirst after righteousness. I pray, Lord, that today, as we open up these truths, this story, that we will taste and see that the Lord is good. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Open up to John chapter 13, the Gospel of John chapter 13. I'm going to be reading, and we're going to be studying today out of the NIV, the New International Version. We're normally in the New King James. So if you need an NIV Bible, our ushers have those today. You can raise your hand and look right out of the NIV with us if you'd like to do that, or you could just follow along with the translation that you have. Over the past 2 weeks in this series, we've talked about rewriting your expectation and rewriting your identity. Today, rewriting your purpose. But the story that we're going to study has all three of those things really beautifully intertwined. We'll see in this momentous event in John the Beloved's Gospel, all of them. Let's begin reading in John chapter 13. We're going to read verses 1 through 17, and then we're going to skip down and read verses 34 and 35, where it says, "It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, 'Lord, are you going to wash my feet?' Jesus replied, 'You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand.' 'No,' said Peter, 'you shall never wash my feet.' Jesus answered, 'Unless I wash you, you have no part with me.' 'Then, Lord,' Simon Peter replied, 'not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well.' Jesus answered, 'A person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you, for he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. 'Do you understand what I've done for you?' he asked them. 'You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them.'" Drop down to verse 34. "A new command I give you. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." This is not a curveball. This is not a split-finger fastball. This is a truth that is teed up for us. I would actually say this is like a softball on a tee. However, historically, the church as a whole, has swung and missed. The church generally has whiffed on this one. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, not by your buildings, not by your politics, not by your supposedly superior morality, not if you wear a Christian t-shirt, not if you have a bumper sticker, not if you, you know, have scripture as your wallpaper on your phone or your ringtone is a hymn, not if you grew up in a Christian home or went to a Christian school. No, if you love one another, by this, all men will know that you are my disciples. Ready? Your purpose is to love. Turn to the person next to you and tell them, say, your purpose is to love. And I know that sounds so simple. And in essence, it is. But it is also infinitely deep. We're going to unpack this story verse by verse today, because the first verse alone is mind-blowing. Take a look at it. It says, it was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. How many of you know timing is everything, right? Timing is everything. This is the time. This is the time. For Israel, as a nation, this is Passover. So it's a sacred part of the year. In the Passover, they'll reenact their deliverance from 400 years of slavery in Egypt. So it's a big deal. Everybody's coming from everywhere. They're all teeming into Jerusalem. Over the past 2 weeks, the only topic in every single synagogue on those Sabbaths would only be the Passover. So it was time. But Jesus also knew that it wasn't just time for Israel. It was time for him. It was his time. It was the Last Supper. This is hours before the dark Garden of Gethsemane. This is the night that he would be betrayed. This is less than 24 hours from when he would be crucified. So it's time. And of course, we love propositions and we love definitions and we love equations. And on this night, Jesus gives us none of those, not a one. He now showed them the full extent of his love. Say that with me today. He now showed them the full extent of his... I mean, every time I read that, I say, wow. The full extent of his love. In other words, where can you find the full measure? An illustration of what the highest degree looks like? A picture of the complete scope and expanse of the love of Jesus Christ? Right here. This is where you can find it, right here. And notice it says, he showed them. He didn't give us an algorithm. He gave us a picture. And of course, that picture will be worth 1,000 times 1,000 words. In verse 2, the evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Right there, real quickly, the meal has already started. The ceremony has already started. There would be two ceremonial hand washings in the meal. The first in the Passover would be just the host. The host himself, at a certain time after the first cup, would get up and wash his hands in front of everyone. And instead of Jesus, the host of the meal, standing up and washing his hands, he stands up and he dons a towel. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. So Jesus stands, and instead of washing hands, he girds a towel, a very specific towel. This towel actually has a name, this towel. In Hebrew, it's the alunthith, and it served as a marking for slaves. It was the slave's towel. Jesus pours water into a common basin, and he begins to wash, and he begins to serve. But there is something so powerful in verse 3. Did you see it? It says, Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. I want you to notice something. Jesus serves out of security. He doesn't serve out of insecurity. You know, when somebody serves out of insecurity, even when somebody just goes to work and does their work out of insecurity, It's to prove something, right? It's to gain people's approval or gain people's acceptance. It's to say, you know, look, I'm competent, so I'm valuable. Look at what I do. Look at how hard I work. Look at what I've accomplished. Because I've accomplished, because I work hard, right, I am somebody, right? My family, what you do or who you know or what you have or what you wear, or where you work, or where you sit, or where you drive, what you drive, or where you live. Let me just tell you right now, none of that will ever be a solid source of security, ever. I mean, really, if you think about it, in essence, it doesn't really matter who likes you or doesn't like you, or who approves you or doesn't approve of you, or who accepts you or who doesn't accept you, because if God be for you, who can stand against you? So Jesus doesn't serve to impress. He doesn't serve to self-promote. He doesn't serve out of insecurity. He serves from a very secure place. He knows who he is. He knows where he's come from. He knows where he's going. He knows what he can do. He knows what he's called to do. He knows what he's anointed and appointed to do. He understands the Father's timing as well. You can see it. Because he has that kind of communion with the Father, he has that kind of closeness, and he has that kind of connection, so there is, in fact, clarity. There's a certainty around his purpose. His expectation is from the Father. His reward is from the Father. His identity comes from the Father. He doesn't have to impress anyone. He lives before an audience of one. He's secure in who he is, and he is secure, listen carefully, in whose he is. And so there's this amazing juxtaposition at this dinner, isn't there? There's Judas on the one hand, just inwardly twisted and tormented, and then there's Jesus with this regal, majestic inner calm as he dons the towel. Now, the seating at the Last Supper is not the way Da Vinci depicted it for us. The seating at the Last Supper would have been more like this. Take a look at this. It would have been a U-shaped table. That would be the place of honor where Jesus is. So Judas is on the one side and John is on the other. My wife pointed out something so beautiful. She said, you know what? When you're fulfilling your purpose, you're always going to have conflict on one side and an ally on the other. Right? Conflict on one side, grace on the other. So anyway, this is the way it really was. And this explains certain things you see in the Bible that John the Beloved talks about, how he reclined on Jesus during this supper. Well, that makes sense. Now we can see how he reclined on him. We see that Peter's on the other side. There's a place where the Bible says Peter actually has to ask John, what did Jesus say? Well, that's because he's on the other side. And we also know that Jesus said, the one who will betray me is the one who dips sop with me. Well, that makes sense. He can tear the bread, hand it to Judas, and they can dip sop together. That's how they are seated. And so at a certain point now in the supper, Jesus gets up and he dons the towel and he walks around to the other side of the table and he approaches Peter. In verse 6, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, you do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. My family, this is kind of a little bit of a side note, but it's important too. Ready? It's important to learn how to receive. It's important to learn how to receive. Some of us in this room, we can't even receive a compliment, right? Somebody says to you, oh, those are really nice shoes. You go, well, they're comfortable. Nobody asks you if they're comfortable. Be quite honest with you, we don't care if you're sprouting a bunion. They look great. But in all seriousness, this is an issue for Peter, and it's an issue for some of us. This is a big part of Peter's problem. He doesn't want to receive. He wants to achieve, right? He wants to defend. He wants to compete. He wants to make these statements of great bravado. You know, he wants to assert himself. You see, Peter wants to rely on his love for the Lord rather than rely on the Lord's love for him. Peter's always trying to prove himself, right? always relying on his efforts and his ideas and his initiatives, on his own good intentions. He trusts his love for the Lord. I mean, if you read further, you'll find out on that same night, right? Peter goes to Jesus and says, listen, if everybody else, if all these other guys, if they all leave you, I won't. I'll go to prison for you. I'll even die for you. And Jesus looks back and says, Pete, that's not how it's going to go down. What's going to happen here actually is, before the rooster crows twice, you're going to deny that you even know me two times. Or the other way around. Rooster crows twice, he'll deny him three times. Peter trusts in his own willpower, man. He's going to get it done. He is a get-her-done kind of guy. He relies on his love for the Lord. How many of you know our love is inconsistent? But his love is completely consistent. Our love is shaky. His love is unshakable. Our love is developing and maturing, and that's a wonderful thing, but his love doesn't have to develop or mature because it is forever settled. His love is firm. His love is finished. It is eternally established and demonstrated on the cross. So rather than trusting in your love for the Lord, receive, rely upon, and rest in the Lord's love for you. Now, here's an obscure promise, but it's one that we don't want to miss. Because the truth of the matter is, we could criticize, you know, Peter till the cows come home. The truth of the matter is, I think we could also relate to Peter because we're an awful lot like him. But I want you to see something. Jesus replied to him. Look at what Jesus said. He said, you do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. Repeat the words of Jesus with me. Ready? You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. One more time. You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. Can I just tell you something? That's a promise. And whenever you get to a place in life, and you may be there now, and if you're not there now, you will be there at a certain time. But if you ever get to a place in life where you just don't get it, you don't understand what in the world is going on. Why are these things taking place? I just don't understand. Ready? You've got a promise. You may not understand right now, but you will. You will. Just hang in there. You're going to understand. Maybe not now, maybe not this week, maybe not this month, maybe not this year, but you will at the right time, at the time that you need to, when God finally pulls back the curtain, there will be a day when you will understand, when it will make perfect sense to you as to why you went through what you did go through. You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. So ready, my family? Listen carefully. Be at peace. There's a purpose. Be at peace. You know, we say this here a lot, but I want to say it again today. You may not understand, but you're not always called to understand everything. You and I cannot understand everything. You and I have finite brains that are locked in between these ears. You can't figure out everything. If you could figure out everything, you'd be God. So it's not always about understanding something, but it is always about standing under the presence and power and promises of God. Be at peace. There's a purpose. There's a reason why you have to make the sacrifices you are making right now in your life. You know, and as I was putting this message together, I know that this point right here is prophetic for somebody. You're not getting it right now. Stop trying to get it. Just know this, one day you will. Yeah, one day it'll make sense. The sacrifices that you're making right now, one day it's going to make sense. It doesn't right now. There's a reason why you have to pass this test. I mean, think of Abraham. The Bible says the Lord tested Abraham and told him, take your son, your only son, the son whom you love, and take him up to the mount that I will show you and sacrifice him there. Do you think Abraham said, okay, great, got it. I understand that completely. That, Lord, makes perfect sense. Of course not. He had to be thinking, what? Is that really you, Lord? I rebuke you, Satan, in the name of Jesus. You know, all these things have got to be flooding his mind. But there's a test, and you got to pass it. There's a sacrifice that has to be made. Because in the end, it'll speak. And in the end, you won't actually have to sacrifice, really. Your willingness to do so will show me, the Lord says, that you put me first. And the reason why I'm bringing you to this place, you don't understand it now. But once you get to the top of that mountain, you're going to understand that I have provided a ram in the thicket. I've brought you to this mountain to show you who I am and who you are in me. When you get to the top of this mountain, you're going to find out who you are, that you really are confirmed as a father of many nations. And you're going to find out that I am Jehovah Jireh. Oh, yes. You may not understand why you're under such financial pressure now. You may not understand why you're being treated so unfairly, why they talk about you, why they pass you up for promotions, or why there's a rift in a particular friendship or a fracture in your family, why things didn't turn out the way that you wanted them to, the way that you thought they should or could or would, why you had to endure, why the hardship, why the suffering, why the disappointment, why the hurt, why the pain. You may not understand now, but you will. At some point in the rearview mirror, this is all going to be 2020. And in that day, when you see it for what it is, when you see it through his eyes, you're going to rejoice. You're going to see that God was with you all along, that his hand was guiding you, that his spirit was leading you, that his presence was comforting you. You may not see it now, but you will see it then, that there was actually a purpose in the difficulty. There was a purpose in your hard place. Yes, he really was working all things together for your good, and that your heavenly Father really did always have your best interest at heart. You're going to see it. You needed some character development, man. You needed to let patience have her perfect work. But guess what? Now you're better for it. Oh, yeah, now you're stronger for it. Yeah, you're wiser now. You're more compassionate now. There's a depth in you that you didn't have before. You do not realize what I'm doing now, but later you will understand. And when you do, you'll be able to tuck that away as evidence of my unwavering faithfulness towards you. Peter protests. He says, no, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. See, Jesus is saying this. He's saying, my heart, my desire, my will is to cleanse you. I want to see you clean. I want to see you clean from everything that clogs and everything that corrupts. I want to see you cleansed from the filth that infects. I want your particular prison door to be open. I want to see the effects of abuse and neglect washed away. I want to see your wounds cleansed so you can be part of me. So we can partner together. So we can go on this glorious journey of changing the world together. You in me, I in you. Let's do this. But first, I have to wash away the grime. Watch the parallel verse in Titus chapter 3, verses 4 and 5. It says, but when the kindness, see, this is out of kindness. But when the kindness and the love of God, this was the full extent of his love, right? When the kindness and the love of God, our Savior, toward men appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done. How many of you know you just can't clean yourself like Jesus can clean you? Amen? I said amen. Am I in the right church today? All right, nudge your neighbor. Give him a little elbow, little elbow. Not by works of righteousness that we've done. We've discovered that. We get that. We can't clean up ourselves. Well, you know, you just got to get it together. When are you ever going to get your act together? You know, pause. I'll never forget the day. And for me, I'm 20 years old at this time. I'm an addict. All day, every day, get more, do more, sell more, to get more, do more, sell more. My emotions are a wreck. My life is a wreck. And it's not getting any better. I cannot get my act together. I recognize at this point in my life that I hate my life and I can do nothing about it. I'm in chains. And I will never forget the day after another full night of the word that pops into my mind is debauchery. Not sure what that means, but I'm sure I had a night of it. And passing out probably around 5 a.m., having to get up at 6 a.m. to go to work with my dad. And I just never forget this pivotal moment in my life, because I'm in the van on the way to work with my dad. And I'm just, you know, I guess my face is about this long. And the bags under my eyes are like this. And I remember my father looked over at me and he said, "John, can I ask you a couple questions?" I said, "Yeah, sure." He said, "Is it cocaine?" I looked back and I said, "Yeah, as a matter of fact, it is, yeah." He goes, "Okay, I'm going to ask you another question or two, if that's okay." I said, "Yeah." He said, "Do you owe money?" I said, "Yeah." "Mm-hmm." "How much?" I told him the amount, large. And he said, "Okay, I think I can write you a check." He said, "Can I ask you another question?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "How much longer? How much longer?" And you know what I said? This is one of those moments that God kind of bypasses the human brain and just uses the human mouth to say something. I looked over at my father and I said, "You know, Dad, I don't think much longer." And he said, "Why is that?" And I said, and now those of you who know my story, you know that Phil has been asking me to church every single week for weeks and weeks and weeks. And my friend Phil, I told him, "No, no, 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 no. I don't want to be one of those people. I don't want to be one of those hallelujah people. I'm not going to that church. I'll never go to that church. Sorry, Phil, I can't go this week. I've got a dentist appointment on Sunday," for those of you who are just a little slower. Listen. Yeah, I used every excuse. And that day, as I'm sitting in the van with my dad, I look over and I say, "You know, not much longer." He goes, "Why? How?" I said, "You know what? I think I'm going to go to that church with Phil." And see, I know maybe you don't. Let me connect the dots for you. In that moment, I recognize I can't get it together. I can't save myself. My feet are grimy, and I can't wash them. I can't fix this. But I think I know someone who can. Amen. And he shows up at that church that Phil goes to. You get it? But when the kindness and the love of God our Savior toward men appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Through the washing, say those three words with me. Through the washing, say it again. Through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. That's the picture in John 13. That's the washing. It's a washing of regeneration. It's a washing of renewal. It's a washing of reconciliation. It's a washing that restores and redeems. It's a washing that imparts new life. When Jesus washes feet, do you see it? He doesn't do it in just some sort of compulsory kind of way. He wants to see us clean and whole. He washes us to change us. He washes us to make us what we're supposed to be. You see, here's another point, and an important one. Jesus isn't serving us out of duty. He serves us out of vision. The Lord has a vision for his people. Can I just say it like this? The Lord has a vision for you. The Lord has a vision for you. Yeah, he has a vision for us, what we can be, for what he's called us to be. You know what he's called us to be? He's called us to be a healed people who heal people. Yeah, yeah. A whole people who help make people whole. He's called us to be a redeemed people to redeem, cleansed to cleanse, loved to love. He has a vision. Let me just say it this way. Ready? He has a vision for you of a higher purpose, and I promise your vision is too small. Your vision for you is too small. It's too ordinary. It's too normal. It's too earthbound. It's too tethered to average. It is not insanely great enough. So impetuous Peter, he does a virtual 180, right? And he takes one foot out of his mouth and inserts the other directly, which is really difficult to do, but he nails it, man. He gets a 10 from the judges, right? No. The Lord did not just my head, my hands, and my, not just my feet, my hands and my head too. We pick it up in verse 12. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and he returned to his place. Do you not understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. By the way, that's the first time Jesus has now received these titles. Every other time he kind of deflects attention. Here he receives them for the first time. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them. This is an ultra pivotal moment. It is the moment that he shows them the full extent of his love, right? And he does so by demonstrating in a nutshell what he is all about, what they should be all about, and ready, what we should be all about. He washed dirty feet so we could wash dirty feet. Obviously symbolic, but nonetheless, he is saying, this is what I came to do, and this is what I am sending you to do. This is my purpose, and therefore, this is your purpose. So three takeaways today. Let's see how fast we can get through them. Number one, we are called to unattractive action. Say it with me. We are called to unattractive action. How many of you know Jesus doesn't fix hair and call us to go and fix hair, right? He doesn't do that. He doesn't trim beards and say, go ye into all the world and trim beards. That's not what he does. He doesn't tailor make a suit and say, now go out and make suits. No, he washes feet, which in Jesus' day was nothing less than repulsive. Repulsive. These are not pedicured feet. These are nasty, gnarly, first century fishermen feet. Now, you bring it into the 21st century, I guarantee you, if we did a poll in this room right now and we asked everybody in this room, what is the most unattractive thing about you, and we tallied up the votes at the end, number one would be my feet. Mm-hmm. Don't point at your spouse right about now. Don't do it. Mother Teresa prayed this. Watch. Oh, Jesus, grant that even if you are hidden under the unattractive disguise of anger, of crime, or of madness, I may recognize you and say, Jesus, you who suffer, how sweet it is to serve you. Jesus is calling us to do that which is unattractive to us. And you got to dial in here. You've got to really get this. See, in our culture, to love means to be attracted to. To love means to be drawn to in our culture. We love people we want to be with. We love people that we're attracted to. And that can be romantically, but it's not limited to that. We're not just talking about romantic attraction, right? We're attracted to success. We're attracted to intellect. We're attracted to power. We're attracted to talent or humor or people who are well connected or people who are kind and have warm dispositions. We're attracted to that. Why are we so attracted to that? Because in every one of us, we have needs. We have needs. We have needs for self-worth. We have needs for belonging, for power, for comfort, for control. So whenever we get into the presence of someone that we believe can meet those needs, then we are viscerally attracted to them. So here's what happens. A lot of what we call love, because we're attracted to someone who we believe can meet a need for us, a lot of what we call love is not love, it's self-serving. Oh, you make me feel good about myself, so I want to be around you. Oh, you like me? You love me? Well, therefore, that makes me feel more important. I feel loved. I feel better about myself. Can I just tell you right now, my brothers and sisters, that's not love. It's not. You're not loving them for them. You're loving yourself through them and using that person as a commodity to get your own needs met. Are you following me? That's self-serving. That's not love. So what is the love that Jesus is calling us to? Well, it is the exact opposite of that. Not your life for mine, but my life for yours. Say it with me today. Not your life for mine, but my life for yours. Say it again. Not your life for mine, but my life for yours. Your life for mine is fear-based. It speaks to my insecurities. It speaks to my own needs. And if it is fear-based, it is not love. How many of you know the Bible says there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear? Are you with me today? Are you here? I was going to tell you a story, but it'll drag it out too long. It's all right? How many of you give me 5 minutes? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. No, that is such a terrible preacher's joke, isn't it? That's just like Velveeta cheese, right? But anyway. Okay, so here's the joke. There was a husband and wife getting married, right? Married. And they were going off to Hawaii on their honeymoon. And so the best man thought, you know what? When they get to the hotel in Hawaii, I want to surprise them with something pretty cool. I'm going to have them send some flowers to their hotel room in Hawaii and a little card. I'll have the florist draw it. So he calls up the florist and he says, listen, here's their hotel room and everything. Send them flowers and put on the card 1 John 4:18, which is the scripture I just quoted to you. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Very nice thing to have with the flowers at the honeymoon hotel room. And so when the couple gets into their hotel room, they see the flowers. They say, how nice is this? But the florist got he got it wrong a little bit on the card. He didn't put 1 John 4:18. He wrote John 4:18. And so they were like, wow, this is awesome. John 4:18, gee, I wonder what that is. And they get their Bible out real quick and they read, and the man that you have now is not your own. Anyway, I just wanted to share that with you. There's really no, like, point to the story. Your life for mine. Not your life for mine. But my life for yours. That's the operating principle that Jesus is teaching us. Now, understand this. We live in the first culture ever that says no to that. That's wrong. Don't do that. We live in a culture that actually says do not give of yourself, assert yourself. We live in a culture that says, listen, pull out of any relationship that is not fulfilling your needs. Now, there is a balance to that, and there are boundaries to that. We don't have time for that right now. But just understand this. If you are a well-adjusted person today, it's because somewhere in your life, someone operated in their relationship with you as my life for yours. And if you never had anybody who did that for you, if you've never had anybody in your life who laid down their life for you while you were growing up, well, then you're probably suffering for it now, and you've got to work through more things than most. See, when someone serves, when someone says, you know what, your interest ahead of mine, your needs, you know, before mine, my life for yours, there's a certain death to that. You understand that? There's a death to self. There's a death to your convenience, and there's a death to your comfort, and there's a death to your control, and a death to your agenda. But that is a death, my family, that always leads to life. Let me read to you quickly C.S. Lewis, the first of two quotes from him, but I think it's beautiful. He says, to love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything, and your heart will be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to be sure of keeping your heart intact, you must give your heart to no one, not even an animal. Wrap it up carefully around with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Lock it up safely in the casket of your selfishness. And in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will not change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, and irredeemable. The only place outside of heaven where you can be perfectly safe from dangers of love is hell. See, the truth is, the more you live my life for yours, the more you become like Jesus. The more you live your life for mine, you become more like Satan. Your life for mine, looks like life, but it spreads death. My life for yours is a death that spreads life. So that's the operating principle. That's the meaning of the symbolism. That's the picture. It's what the picture points to. And number two, ready? Our purpose is not just surface level serving, but emotional investment. See, our culture makes the mistake of saying love is attraction, but it also makes the mistake of saying, okay, well then, if it's not attraction, then it's duty. Love is duty. Love is a matter of the will. It's a have to. It's not a matter of the emotions. Because after all, doesn't the Bible command us to love? And if the Bible commands us to love one another, then it can't be an emotion. Nobody can command you to have a feeling. If the Bible commands us to love, then all we have to do is serve people. Do our duty. You know, it's an act of the will. That's all there is to it. But I want to tell you this today. Ready? If you think that love is a duty, you're not really doing your duty. Because the duty that Jesus Christ calls us to is to care. That's really the bottom line. It's to care. Not just to robotically go through the motions of anything. Certainly not love. It makes no sense. The duty that Jesus Christ calls us to is to care about the effect of your service. Not just to serve people, not just to check a box, not just to, okay, serve, did that, tick the box, I can take that off my to-do list. No, no, no. Your duty is to care about the effect of your service. And if you will really care, it will always engage the heart. And again, if Jesus is the example, how many of you know Jesus does not show up at Lazarus' tomb and say, hey, Martha, Mary, where'd you lay him? Move the stone. Everybody stand back. Here we go. Lazarus, come forth. He doesn't do that. No, what does the Bible say he does there? He weeps. And then he groans in the spirit. My family, that's emotional investment. That is caring. That is emotional connection. That's emotional engagement. Again, C.S. Lewis, he said, I love this. This is amazing. He says, remember that the dullest and most uninteresting person you can talk to may one day be a creature, which if you saw it now, you would be strongly tempted to worship, or else a horror and a corruption such as you now meet, if at all, only in a nightmare. All day long, we are, in some degree, helping each other to one or the other of these destinations. It is in the light of these overwhelming possibilities, it is with the awe and the circumspection proper to them that we should conduct all our dealings with one another, all friendships, all loves, all play, all politics. There are no ordinary people. You've never talked to a mere mortal. Nations, cultures, arts, civilizations, these are mortal. But it is immortals whom we joke with, work with, marry, snub, and exploit, immortal horrors or everlasting splendors. My family, we are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. We are not just a bunch of bodies. We are not just a bunch of robots. We are not just a bunch of numbers. We are souls. And every time somebody acts or acts upon someone with a my life for yours operating principle, you're moving people towards love. You're moving them towards connection. You're moving them towards God. And every time someone acts or is acted upon with a your life for mine worldview, when someone is used or someone is exploited or somebody is stepped on as another climbs the ladder to the top, then guess what? You're moving, but you're moving in the wrong direction. Jesus has a vision for the human race. And through the foot washing, he is saying, I have a vision for what people can become, I of what you can become. And therefore, I'm washing you and I'm serving you, but to that end. And the question is, do we have the same vision? A vision of unattractive action and emotional investment, because that's what Jesus is calling us into and that's what he's communicating. It's having a vision for hurting and lost people who you wouldn't normally be attracted to. And seeing them and saying, what would they be like? What would their life be like if I served them? What would their life be like? What would be the result? What would be the fruit if I really cared enough to get my hands dirty with the grime on their feet? What would they wind up being? Probably joyful, awakened, feeling cared for, feeling like they are somebody. thankful, valued. Maybe they start to pay it forward. See, this is not just sacrificial service. This is not, you know what this is? This is filling your heart with what it could mean. It's caring about what people become. And so now, through the foot washing, Jesus says, let me show you the full extent of my love. This is my purpose, and this is your purpose. To engage in unattractive action, and not just to do your duty, but to really care. To be emotionally engaged. To have a vision for what people with dirty feet can become. And if you're like me, I look at this and my response is, oh, snap. Right? You look at this and you've got to, if you're being honest, you got to say, really? To this degree? That's scary. It's hard. How many of you know love is scary? I said, how many of you know love is scary? How many of you know love is hard? And the reason why we look at this and all the other things that Jesus says about love, and we look at all the things that he says and we say, impossible. Remember, you shall love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. And in essence, he's saying all the time. And we look at that and say, I can't. And the reason why we look at his claims and his directives and his instruction about love and we land on, I can't. Here's why. We look at it, we say, how can I love like that? How can I be willing to lay aside my own needs? How can I? Here's the reason why. Because, simply put, in and of ourselves, in our own flesh, from our own resources, guess what? We have an inner emptiness and an inner poverty. We have to love people who love us back because we need those needs met. We're often empty. I can't give it away if I'm not full. How do I love like that? And you know what? When you get to that place, you know what Jesus says to you? Good answer. That's right. Blessed are the poor in spirit. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when you come to the place where you say, I can't do this myself. I don't have this in my own lower human nature. I can't pull this off. I can't make this happen. I can't just. And Jesus looks at you and he smiles and he says, that's right, you can't. But I can. Oh, but I can. And I have. And I do. And I always will. You can't. Absolutely right. But I can. You can't do this on your own. But I can through you. Therefore, you can through me. In other words, Jesus is saying, listen, I can give you this love. You may not have it on your own, but I can give it to you. Oh, I can give you an unlimited supply. I can give you a fountain that never runs dry. I can give you an ever-flowing stream of this incredible love. I can do this. So number three on your outline and finally is love and serve out of fullness. Love and serve out of fullness. Remember, Jesus washed feet. He loved and he served not out of insecurity, right? But out of security. He didn't love and serve out of emptiness. He loved and served out of fullness, right? And that's how he wants you and I to love and serve. From fullness, from security, from knowing who you are and what you have in him. He wants you to serve out of the understanding of what you can do, of the identity that you have in him, the expectation that you have in him, that your reward is from him, that your confidence is in him, that your affirmation comes from him, that your applause is the applause of heaven. You know where you've come from. You know where you're going. You know who you are, and you know whose you are. In Romans 5, it says the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. So how do we receive that? How does that flow? How do we serve and love out of fullness and out of security? How does that actually happen? Ready? Two things. First, let Jesus wash your feet. Let Jesus wash your feet. Oh, you got to tell the person next to you this. Go ahead, tell them. Say, let Jesus wash your feet. Yes, tell the person on the other side. Go ahead, tell them too. I know it's a little awkward, but go ahead and tell them. Say, let Jesus wash your feet. Those of you who are sitting alone are really happy right now. But anyway, not too many of you today. What's hindering you from loving people? What learned behavior? What's stopping you from fulfilling your purpose if your purpose is to love? Let Jesus wash it away. He wants to. Even if you tell him no, he's like, we need to do this. Okay, my hands and my head too. Let him wash away your fears. What are you so afraid of? Let him wash away your intimidation. Let him wash away your hurt and your pain. Let him wash away your past. Let him wash away your pride. Let him wash away all of your insecurity. Let him wash away your brokenness. Everything that hinders. Listen, what stops you from reaching out? What stops you from forgiving? What stops you from saying, I'm sorry? What stops you from loving? Whatever it is today, in this place, let him wash it away. And then finally, secondly, yes, first let Jesus wash your feet, and secondly, fill your heart with what he has done. Stop focusing on the problem. Stop focusing on self. And start focusing on the one who gives us great and precious promises. Fill yourself with what he has done. Through prayer, through worship. I know you're being very long-winded today, but I just want to say one more thing. Guys, listen. This is daddy talk right here. This is Papa John without the pizza talking to the church. We got to get to the place. And of course, I'm not talking about you, but I am talking about the person next to you. Listen, we've got to get to the place as a church where we worship in an unabandoned, in an abandoned way, unreserved and abandoned. Thank you. Can I just tell you, it hurts my heart to walk into the back of the church and to see the worship team going at it and the church like this? And we're singing songs like, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is Thy Faithfulness. Oh God, my Father. Yeah. If the shoe fits, wear it. Okay? I said, if the shoe fits, wear it. Because there is something transformational about when we fully engage in worship. We're filling our hearts, we're filling our lives with what he has done. When we close our eyes and don't care less about what the person next to us or behind us thinks, we're like David who said, I'll be even more undignified than this. And he's twirling about. Anyway, let me leave that alone. Fill your heart with what he's done. And one of the ways you do that is worship. And yeah, definitely on Sunday morning, but not just on Sunday morning. And you don't need a great voice. You can make a joyful noise unto the Lord in your shower, in your car. But through prayer, through worship, through meditation, through contemplation, through times in your life when you want to be still and know that he is God, when you want to be absolutely silent and just sink it in. But those are times that we remember and those are times that we recall. We call those things to mind. We meditate. We feed on his faithfulness. And the Bible says over and over and over again, that's how our lives are changed. That's how we're transformed. Think on these things. Practice his presence. Dwell on his goodness. Fill yourself with the fact that he washed away your dirt. That he washed your wounds. that he washed you whiter than snow, that he saved you, that he delivered you, that he lifted you, that he rescued you, that he set you free from to set you free to, that he's called you out so he could bring you in, that he chose you and he paid the price and he took every curse and he broke every chain and he's blessed you and he's favored you and he's filled you. It was his life for yours. The death that brought you life. That's how much he loved you. The great theologian and thinker, Karl Barth, was asked, what is your most profound thought? What is your most profound truth? And without blinking an eye, Karl Barth looked back and he said, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. How many of you know God loves you?
Yes.
How many of you know he paid the price?
Yes.
How many of you know he did all that? One last story. Can I tell you one last story?
Yes.
Okay, one last story. If you say no, I'm going to do it anyway. But anyway, in Christian love. But anyway, Tsar Nicholas I of Russia made it a practice of every now and then dressing in regular soldiers' clothes, and he'd go and he'd inspect the troops, and they wouldn't know that it was him. There's a story of him doing that one day to a young man whose father Nicholas grew up with. So they knew each other before he was czar, and so he knew the family, knew the young man. When the young man went into the military, he was given a really nice post. He was given the head of the treasury, the military treasury for Russia at the time. What nobody knew about the young man, however, was that he had a gambling addiction. And so little by little, he gambled away all of his own money. And now he's the treasurer over the military budget, and he starts to take a little bit here and a little bit there from the military until one day he gets a letter, and the letter says, somebody is coming to inspect. We want you to do all the books, reconcile everything. We want every single ruble accounted for. And so he broke out the books, and he spent all night going over and tabulating what he owed. He said, well, once I tabulate it, I'll pay it back. And so he tabulated here a little, there a little, and it all added up to an incredible amount of money. When he saw it, he got out a little piece of paper and he put it on the books and he wrote, so great a debt, who can pay? And with that, he fell into a deep despondency and got out his revolver. But the room, it was said, was rather damp and rather warm. And in that damp, warm room, he fell asleep. On the one side, the books with so great a debt, who can pay? And the other side of his desk, the revolver. And in that moment, as he's sleeping, the czar shows up in regular soldier gear. And he walks in, but he can see the young man sleeping. Now, he knows the young man. He sees him sleeping, and so he tiptoes over. And he sees the revolver, and he sees the books, and he sees the note, and he looks at it, and in just a moment, he puts it all together. Oh. So great a debt, who can repay? And Nicholas takes the pen, and he writes one word. And he tiptoes out. But when he closes the door, the young man wakes up. And he remembers, and he goes and he reaches for the revolver. But as he reaches for the revolver, the paper catches his eye, and he sees on the paper, so great a debt, who can repay? Nicholas? Nicholas can repay. Nicholas has a lot of rubles. Nicholas? The next day, as the story goes, military officers arrive at this young man's office with bags upon bags upon bags of rubles to be put back into the military treasury, and he goes absolutely free. My family, let me tell you something today. You and I, we have a debt so great, who can repay? But on the note, on your account, it's not Nicholas, it's Jesus. And he has repaid every debt. And his kindness and his love is that great. See, he's not just our example of foot washing. He's our substitutionary sacrifice. And so, yes, absolutely, your purpose is to love. So let Jesus wash your feet. Let him sign your note. Fill your heart with that. Fill your heart with what he's done for you so that you can love and serve out of fullness.